listen to you because we think that despite everything else, you are still the one we always are aiming for. If we are thinking about worldviews, intellectual discourse, and so forth that we run for. So therefore, it was exciting that despite the unity of which it had in the House of Commons as well as at you know, some other places within think tanks, that despite the collaboration with the Brexit at all, the UK is still ready to go abroad and across the world. And we are looking forward, since we are going to face the same problems, that you, with your experience, having an illustrious career as politician, as well as, you know, of course, you know, a member of a very important one, and in charge as Minister of State, of course, in charge for Asia, for Asia, and the Pacific, to be able to give us some lights, some highlights, how you are thinking about a new role that the UK and Great Britain is looking for in the future, and where we and ASEAN can fit together. So, without further ado, because Minister Perry is here, I would like to invite you to get your introduction. Please. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Randy, and thank you to CSIS for allowing me to host or to speak to you today, because it's a great pleasure for me to be here in Jakarta. It's my first stop in a 13-day, six-country, nine-city visit across Southeast Asia. I'm exhausted at the prospect of it. I'll look exhausted. I'll look at least 12 days older, I suspect, by the time I return to London. But I was appointed as a Minister of State for Asia Pacific just over a year ago. During that time, I have crisscrossed across the region, from Beijing to Bangkok, from Kuala Lumpur to Kathmandu, and from Hanoi to Honiara. Over the next 2 weeks, I shall be adding Brunei, Manila, Vientiane, Phnom Penh, as well as the significant Asian diaspora in the UK. But I rarely have the opportunity to talk about the UK approach to Asia as a whole. And as has been rightly pointed out, given the obsession that we have at the moment and back in the UK with Brexit, it is perhaps a great relief that that particular phrase will not pass my lips at least in the next 15 minutes or so. I think the UK government's approach on Asia is one that encompasses all of Asia, and as such, I'd like to venture to say that we are following in your ancestors' footsteps. Now, as far back as the 7th century, the Sriwijaya Empire, based here in modern-day Indonesia, built flourishing trade routes that spanned the whole of this continent, from India to China, and indeed right across Southeast Asia. Engaging with all the nations and regions of Asia was a right approach in the 7th century, and it is even more so today, as the whole world tilts towards this vibrant, diverse continent, with its enormous opportunities, as well as some very real challenges. Now, I should perhaps say my own passion for Asia long predates my appointment as a minister. You might indeed say I was born with it, because it was in 1962 that my parents were married just across the Sea of Java in Singapore. My father at that time was stationed there with the British Army. And so I grew up really with hearing great stories about life in this part of Asia. My interest grew stronger when I first visited over 20 years ago. It was already so very different from my parents' photographs. And of course, that change has continued apace over the past two decades. Quite likely, the UK's relationship with Asia has changed too, from that of my parents' time more than half a century ago to the partnership that we enjoy today with our eyes very firmly placed on the future. I've seen plenty of evidence of that myself, but I've also been struck by this region's sheer diversity. To any Asian audience, I know this is just obvious, but with a population of well over 3 billion people, more than 2,000 languages, and a vibrant mix of faiths and communities, Asia is both everything you can imagine and nothing that you can expect really is diversity at its very, very finest. But most of all, I have been staggered, by the palpable sense of energy that is evident right across this region. Whether it's booming tourism, smart technology, prodigious flows of business and trade, growth rates that I'm afraid us in the West can only dream of, but above all, the economic ingenuity of the people, a very dynamic drumbeat of enterprise that is setting the rhythm across the globe. And crucially, it's a drumbeat that is being driven by the young. More people live in Asia than in the rest of the world combined, and over a third of those are under the age of 25. And of course, Asia, therefore, could quite rightly be proud to say that it represents the future of this planet. All of which explains why it's so important for the UK government to operate an all of Asia policy. And I use that phrase, all of Asia, very deliberately. We have sometimes, I think, been accused of being too focused on the largest economies in this region to the exclusion of others. That wasn't true in the past, and it's not true now. For centuries, the UK has recognised the tremendous opportunities throughout this region. The context may have changed, but we have been engaged in all of Asia ever since. All of Asia is just some catchy phrase for think tanks, academics, and the media. I'm aware that one or two of those industries are represented here today. It is a reality, and that's why the UK has some 50 diplomatic missions across Asia, including presence in all 10 members of ASEAN. And it's why we're expanding still further, opening 3 new posts in the Pacific and boosting the numbers of diplomats who are posted in this region. There are some really hard-headed reasons for doing so, because decisions taken by Asian nations directly affect the British economy and economic interests. If we are to engage effectively, we need to be active and present right across this region. And that's why I have made a point in my own role of covering as much of this ground as possible. By the end of this trip, I can proudly say that I will have visited all 10 ASEAN countries in just over a year, and some of them twice. That, I hope, shows just how much this vital pillar of the continent matters to the United Kingdom. The conversation with ASEAN member states on our post-Brexit relationship with ASEAN is well underway to ensure that we maintain a close bond through a formal connection that is as broad and ambitious as possible. Of course, as many of you will know, the UK has long had very strong bilateral links across this region, be it through governments, business, schools, and critically our people. But once the UK is outside of the EU, our room for manoeuvre will of course be even greater. Many of my counterparts recognise the brief period of uncertainty that all of this brings, but they speak enthusiastically of the new opportunities for bilateral cooperation with the UK that will follow it. And yes, that will include free trade agreements and enhanced trading partnerships. Because partnership is central to all we do here in Asia. All of Asia is about working together to promote and to protect the things that matter most to all of us, both directly between nations and through the multinational institutions that we hold dear. As we will do with our Indonesian friends, of course, on the UN Security Council from January. I have to say I'm absolutely delighted to see Indonesia back on the UN Security Council. I think it's a tremendous opportunity for the next 2 years for a country of 260 million people and rising to show itself on the global stage. And I know that there's been a tendency perhaps for Indonesia to do a lot of its work beneath the radar. And I think this is a real opportunity at the top stage. And you know, I know from my own perspective as a British minister, and as a permanent member of the Security Council here in the UK, we'll do our level best to make sure that we find as much common ground that we can work on. I think there are a range of issues, not just issues in places such as Myanmar or North Korea, but actually also on issues close to our heart, such as climate change and plastics, for example, which I know are issues that need to be addressed on a global basis. So let me say a little bit, if I may, about some of my priorities as Minister of State for Asia and the Pacific. And there are three in the main: prosperity, security, and values. On the issue of values and the rules base in international system. It is with the basic freedoms and values that we hold so dear, those enlightened and humane values that have the deepest roots here in the soil of Asia, that I would like to start. The UK will continue to be a steadfast advocate for democracy, human rights, and the rule of law. We believe that people here in Asia and the world over should be free to express themselves and live the lives they choose. It means being free to engage in healthy debate, both face-to-face and online. It means being able to practice our faith or change it without fear of discrimination, or, of course, being free to have no faith at all. It means being valued when we contribute, regardless of religion, gender, ethnicity, or sexual orientation. And it means making the very most of our diversity. In the words of Indonesia's national motto, it is unity in diversity. Why the UK supports these freedoms and will continue to promote them across the world. It's why, for example, we stand up and will continue to stand up for the rights of the people of Hong Kong and for the principle of one country, two systems that was signed up for between the UK and China. In this year alone, I have discussed concerns about freedom of religion or belief in Nepal and Pakistan. And during that, the most recent trip to China, I raised our concerns about the region of Xinjiang amid reports of oppression and re-education centers. In Burma or Myanmar, I've highlighted and continue to highlight the need for those who have perpetrated atrocities to be brought to justice. And we shall do so, UN Security Council, we have the presidency this month, we shall do so in an emergency debate on the 28th of this month. In Thailand and Cambodia, I've encouraged the authorities to create conditions for elections that are free, fair, and transparent. And in the Maldives, we've joined with partners across the world in speaking out against those who seek to undermine the democratic process. Now, these are just a few examples which illustrate some points of concern, but there are also some very powerful examples of how open societies and democracies and their principles have won through. With over 800 million voters, India is right supposed to be the world's largest democracy. Malaysia's elections provided an emphatic endorsement of the power of democracy, something already vibrant in Indonesia. And in the months ahead, I look forward to seeing the peoples of Thailand, of Bangladesh and Afghanistan, as well as, of course, here in Indonesia, expressing their views about the box of free, fair, and fully participatory elections. The UK's next priority across Asia is our common prosperity. It is, I think, central to the successful, thriving, and sustainable societies of the future. Many of the industries that will be vital for building that successful future are still in their infancy, as indeed are the regulations and directives that will govern. We can and we must now work together to fashion a common approach. And whilst we should celebrate the fact that a number of Asian countries have reached or are beginning to reach middle income status, we all know that across the region there are many huge disparities in wealth, in education, and in opportunity. Many governments face a very serious challenge that is creating quality jobs to meet people's aspirations. In India alone, a million new job seekers enter the market each and every month. This is where I hope the UK can offer support to partners across Asia in four key areas. The first is education. Our global campaign to promote 12 years of quality education, especially for girls, was endorsed by no fewer than 53 leaders at April's Commonwealth Summit in London, including 18 countries from Asia. Since 2011, we've supported more than 6.8 million primary school children in Pakistan and a similar number neighboring Afghanistan. In Southeast Asia, our Education is Great campaign is reaching out to more than 600 million people, promoting the value of education and the English language, the official language, as you know, of ASEAN. Meanwhile, the largest number of overseas students in the UK are from China. Five branch campuses of UK universities in Malaysia, as well as those in China, demonstrate the huge appetite for top quality British education, as of course does the very biggest challenge for our prestigious achieving scholarships, of which I'm very glad Indonesia is a leading player. Secondly, we are working together to improve the business climate, vital, I think, to encourage investment and creating jobs in the future. Across Asia, we should invest some £200 million through the Prosperity Fund and other programs to help lift people out of poverty over the next 5 years by improving the conditions which they can do business. Here in Indonesia, we're helping develop a robust digital procurement system that will reduce corruption and increase transparency. In the Philippines, we have supported the government with their Easy Doing Business Act, and we've recently concluded an MOU with the United Nations Development Programme to help promote a fairer business environment within ASEAN. Meeting that demand for modern infrastructure across all of Asia is vital to ensure the continent is free, open, and prosperous. Not just to get millions of more people physically from A to B efficiently and sustainably, but also to connect them so they can access the online marketplace. The UK has world-class professional and financial expertise to help Asia meet that demand and to source the funds it needs to support jobs, sustainable growth and prosperity. We have the cutting-edge technical know-how and world-leading financial plant in the City of London, which is a constituency I've been very proud to represent as its MP these past 17 years. London is the undisputed global centre for infrastructure finance. It's a natural hub for green finance, a vital contributor of new international financial products, such as the Indian rupee denominated SALA bonds underpinned in London, and it is a growing hub for international Islamic finance. It may come as a surprise to some of you that the UK is the very first nation to issue a sovereign sukuk, or Sharia compliant bond, and that to date, London Stock Exchange has issued some $48 billion worth of these bonds. I've also had the great pleasure, and it has been a great pleasure, I have to say, of attending the launch of the first two Indonesian Komodo bonds to be launched in London just either side of Christmas. We recognise the importance of China's Belt and Road Initiative also for meeting Asia's infrastructure needs. And that's why we have appointed a dedicated envoy for professional and financial services who's working to promote our unique offer and to ensure that investments in Belt and Road are the right ones and that they meet high international standards. Now, the third area I want to discuss was research, innovation and everything that is going to be associated with the phrase the fourth industrial revolution. Technology, self-evidently, holds the key to unlocking many of the problems, future problems that this world faces. The UK and our Asian partners strengthen science, technology, and innovation, meaning we have a great deal to offer each other. Now, I saw some of the fruits of that cooperation in a robotics and regenerative medicine lab in Osaka, in Japan, where I simultaneously found myself both in the future and in the past when I came face to face with Leonardo da Vinci reincarnated in robot form. When I was in China last month, I saw many examples of our collaboration with Chinese institutions. I met professors from Oxford, Cambridge and King's College London and saw an impressive UK-China research centre work on plant science in Beijing. This kind of collaboration is at the heart of the people-to-people relationship that we have throughout this region, which will bring with it regional prosperity. In India, our UK-India technology partnership will work in areas such as AI and health, in healthcare, electric vehicles and advanced manufacturing to create new opportunities for growth and jobs. Now, the fourth area of cooperation under the prosperity umbrella is about laying the groundwork for future free trade agreements and trade partnerships across this region. The UK has and will always be a global champion of free and open international trade. After Brexit, we intend to work quickly to establish a new economic partnership based on the final terms of the EU-Japan Joint Partnership Agreement. Japan, of course, is the second biggest source of non-European FDI into the UK. Thanks to our Japanese friends, a vehicle comes off the British production line every 20 seconds. We should also seek to transition EU free trade agreements with Singapore, Vietnam and Korea, whilst exploring new opportunities, such as FTAs, Australia and New Zealand, potential membership of the comprehensive and progressive Trans-Pacific Partnership, and also enhanced trading relationships across the region. But we all know that there can be no lasting prosperity and security. And that's why it's so important that we, the UK, and the countries of this region work together to uphold the rules-based international order. I believe that between us, we have a lot to offer. The UK is a permanent member of the UN Security Council, a committed member of NATO, the G20 and the Commonwealth, and an active participant in the five-power defence arrangements in Southeast Asia. We have a world-class military reputation. We're the only G20 member that spends both 2% of our GDP on defence and 0.7% of GDP on overseas development. And we have and will continue to stand shoulder to shoulder with Japan, South Korea and other countries in denouncing the nuclear adventurism of North Korea. It's why we urge all parties to respect freedom of navigation in the international water of the South China Sea, including the ruling of the Permanent Court of Arbitration in The Hague on this matter. Our money and military presence are playing their part across Asia. As one of the few countries able to deploy air power some 7,000 miles from our shore, in 2016 we sent our typhoons to train in Japan, South Korea, and Malaysia for the very first time. Our Royal Navy has deployed two ships to the Asia Pacific this year, HMS Albion and HMS Sutherland, with another visit to come from HMS Argyle by the end of the year. Our almost unbroken naval presence provides a visible demonstration of the UK's commitment to the enforcement of the UN Security Council sanctions, but also generally to peace, to security, and to prosperity in this region. We are strong members of the five powers of defence arrangements alongside Australia, New Zealand, Malaysia, and Singapore. And British forces, Brunei, have remained there since independence in 1962 at the invitation of His Majesty the Sultan. And we are enhancing security and defence relationships elsewhere in the region, both through joint military exercises with South Korea and Thailand. We're committed to a secure, free, open, and prosperous Indo-Pacific, playing an active role in maritime security in the Indian Ocean through military, multinational, and commercial engagement and capacity building. And we've also used our expertise in maritime domain awareness to support regional initiatives here in the Indian Ocean. As the world's primary hydrographic charting authority, I can also proudly report that we are taking steps to chart the ocean alongside our partners, helping to improve safety at sea, trade, and security. And also building a new framework for cyber security cooperation with India and countries in the region. We have signed an MOU on this very issue this morning with my counterpart at Foreign Affairs Office. And we are strengthening counter-terrorism cooperation with a new regional counter-terrorism hub. But Asia also faces challenges related to ongoing and past conflict, and we have an enduring commitment to Afghanistan, as shown by our recent commitment to a troop uplift. And we're working together with the international community to help Afghanistan become more stable, secure, and self-reliant. The meeting of religious scholars here in Jakarta earlier this year in May did, I think, much to advance the religious narrative in favor of peace. Elsewhere, we're clearing landmines in Cambodia and Vietnam, and we're providing £129 million of assistance to date to the Rohingya people from Burma who have been forcibly displaced from their homes. These, I think, are tangible signs of our ongoing commitment to all of Asia and our wish to intensify our partnerships in the region. Crucially, they also illustrate our determination to ensure that disputes in this region are resolved not through force, through militarization, or through coercion, but rather through dialogue and in accordance with international law. Let me conclude by I think I've given just a small snapshot of UK activity across Asia. I hope that I have been able to demonstrate emphatically that our All of Asia policy is broad, ambitious, and focused on the future. I recognise that Asia will be the crucible in which the world of the 21st century will be forged, fueled in large part, as I say, by the energy, by the creativity and the entrepreneurship of millions of young people growing up in Asia today. And all of our All Asia policy is tailored to the things that will matter most to them, getting a good education, finding a decent job, having their rights respected and feeling confident that their future is secure. It is about working together with all of Asia in a partnership of equal, working together to build a future that is safer, more free, more prosperous, a future in which we all contribute fully and achieve our full potential. So I look forward to working with many of you today towards this shared goal. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Mr. You have not given only a tool to the horizon, what the vision is actually thinking about the world, but also particularly of this part of the world, but also a tool to force what you are going to do with us. That is great. Now, let me open the floor for questions and answers, and maybe discussions if you have some other ideas to move forward to the minister. The lady here, can you identify yourself? Yes, please.
Can you come to the microphone and identify yourself and your affiliation?
What has happened in the last decade and a half is impoverished you might be when if you come to the West, to a European country, from abroad, one of the things we recognize almost immediately is that education is the ladder to opportunity for the next generation. And looking at those academic results, so, listen, we don't get everything right across the world, and I think it is a worry that there are significant numbers of people being left behind. We see it as certainly a worry in the United Kingdom. But equally, the lesson is plain before our eyes. It is to get as strong an education as possible, and that is the way in which you will maximize your opportunities and your prosperity.
Thank you. Shall I be first? Okay, please. And then identify yourself.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Minister. My name is Zhang Bo, from the region of China. So just now you mentioned about the negotiated agreements. So my question is regarding the, you know, that China and the UK are now exploring the possibility of having negotiated agreements after Brexit. So how do we value the possibility of this negotiated agreements? And do you foresee any challenges lying ahead of us when it comes to negotiation? And besides that, how about ASEAN? Does the UK have any plan to have bilateral FTAs with ASEAN? Thank you.
As I mentioned, that we already have ASEAN to be members of the European Union, trade links already with Singapore and Vietnam as far as ASEAN is concerned. We would hope that they, not least, we get to the table helping negotiate those deals with the EU. I think we'll be able to get the transition of those without too much difficulty. Let me just say one thing about the government about free trade agreements. I can't say this is exactly government policy, but I'll be candid with you. After I left university, I read law at university. I became a businessman. I was in business for some 7 or 8 years and sold my share prices when I was led to part to some sort of led by former business partner. I loved being in business. I actually loved small business. I didn't really want to be a big corporate man. I had a business, a startup, made a dozen staff, made a £1 million turnover. I much enjoyed it. But the one thing that struck me, and I'm afraid the state of the union now in my last 17 years as a parliamentarian, is that when you talk about free trade agreements, politicians and civil servants and bureaucrats are talking about free trade agreements. Business people just get on and do business and do trade. There hasn't been a single country that we have signed a free trade agreement with that we haven't really been doing a lot of business with. And I think one of the, in our lifetime, if you look at the way in which the tariffs people under GATT and now the succession of WTO, the Montevideo round of GATT, WTO, the round and the Doha, is that tariffs are now extremely low, non-existent in certain areas. I accept that we have to recognize lots of non-tariff barriers that also prevent entirely free trade. But the world we're living in now is much more engaged towards free trade than has ever been the case before. The case for free trade, whilst populist left of center politicians may try and make them to try and be anti-business, I think the average person in the street knows free trade has given opportunities to their children, their parents and their grandparents could barely believe. So to be a candidate, I'm less worried about the nuts and bolts of any free trade agreement. And I think in many ways we have got good trading relationships with a number of countries. I'm not hopeful that in this region in particular, as I say, we get on for sure watch looking at the TPP, which the United States, in my view, will advise that we walked away from. I think there are tremendous opportunities, and I hope that our friends in this region, certainly as it applies to Japan, South Korea, Australia, New Zealand, and I think some of the ASEAN nations will think that it would be appropriate for us to join as such a agreement. One thing I would say, though, is this, and I'll give you a candid view about how trade agreements got to work. I think the one lesson, one lesson we should learn about leaving the European Union. Recall that Britain had a number of opt-outs from the European Union, not in a single currency, we're not part of the Schengen immigration zone. We for a long time were not members of the social chapter. I think that one lesson that we have to learn, and I think it's something which is quite outside in this other world, the way in which ASEAN has developed in a more slow and deliberate way than perhaps the European Union. is the last step. If we're going to silent agreements in the future, we need to silent the whole lot in way. There's no point in trying to have carve-outs and agreements starting already on that foot in certain areas. We need to be fully engaged with that. But as I say, I don't deny that a lot of activity rightly has gone looking at the ways in which we can work together and sign up to free trade agreements. But I think it's always worth remembering to say that a lot of business gets on. We can just get on and not do business. Having a government signing a free trade agreement doesn't prevent a lot of free trade happening, and I'm therefore confident that given the culture and history that the United Kingdom has had for many centuries of being outward looking as far as trade is concerned, be able to continue that
thing through much of the session. Thank you. Maybe you can explain to the minister what you have proposed when we were talking, you know, with the think tanks. What are we to do together? And then maybe ask his opinion what he thinks about it. May I?
Yes.
Philip, to do that?
Achieving a scholarship scheme just chatting with our ambassador. Carl earlier today came away from a meeting with Secretary General of ASEAN. I'm very happy. We would like to maintain a continuation of the relationship, the transitions through from making a dialogue on that. We think that would be not just a kingdom's interest, we believe it would be an ASEAN interest for the range of reasons that I've addressed about, you know, where we see our relations policy being. And I would very much like to see us do even more than we already do. Maybe we have ASEAN achieving scholarships and some of that order. Years ahead, I think it will be a great benefit. So, you know, and one of the reasons I'm such a great believer in the idea of getting education for, you know, the benefit that we have in the UK, and I think if you go and study for a year or maybe do a full degree, a 3-year degree in a UK university, you're almost certainly going to come back to Indonesia, and you will be an ambassador of the UK hopefully the rest of your life. So you'll have a positive view. There's actually benefit on all sides, both to get hopefully first-rate education, but also, as I say, the benefits of people who have a very positive view, and the fact is that so many people who come from the region have their education in that way, I think it speaks itself. On security, on cyber security, I was very pleased to be signing an MOU, and I think the one thing which I said that I signed it and we agreed with my counterpart in the foreign ministry was to say, you know, we're going to make this work. We're well signing an MOU, you actually have a look at this. And I think there's a real passion to do that for a range of reasons. I mean, there are security aspects that you've touched on, but increasingly technology is going to be so important that actually we need to have some sort of cyber protocol as a result. But also, you know, look at the businesses that are being created. Young entrepreneurs setting up fintech businesses in all parts of Indonesia. It's really so important that we utilize the links that we have the technology across the board. And, you know, I think we're living in a world, as I say, which is developing very fast. And I think you touched on some of the concerns about the United Nations and the UN Security Council and some of its failures. Right? Let me just first of all pay some credit to the work that's been done by Indonesia. And it's crazy for Indonesia or others to beat themselves up and say, well, ASEAN should have done more. About what's happened in Myanmar. Listen, it's been difficult. We all recognize the ethnic issues that are involved. It doesn't just apply to Rohingya, the Chin and the Shan on the Thai border now under even further persecution than themselves. But it was always been difficult for an agreed ASEAN line on this, and I would pay great tribute to your foreign minister, Lorenzo Paul's done a tremendous job, not only behind the scenes, but trying to bring people together. Clearly it's going to be a major issue we get to deal with. You've touched on one or two of the failings we have in our international system. And now, my view is not that, you know, we should say the UN is a total waste of time, and because we've got members, permanent members of the Security Council, having a veto that can actually prevent us being able to criticize, it doesn't justify the United States to what's happening in Myanmar. It applies to chemical weapons, it applies to nuclear prohibition as well. But if the one lesson I've learned from my years in politics, and my particular passion in the last 14 months as a minister, and I had a big party international role for 2 years before that, is that you've actually got to engage. And one of the things about diplomacy is you've got to be patient. And sometimes you'll take 3 steps forward and you'll have to take 2 steps back. There are moments when you're trying to engage when you can get very, very frustrated. But we can't give up. Engaging and trying to work together is the only way that we're going to be able to address many of the very real issues that we face in the world. And I'm very relieved when I come to this part of the world. Not least because actually I think that sense of patience and that sense of perspective for the past but passion for the future is something that's probably more engaged from the rather short-termist approach that we often have in the West. Therefore, the skills of diplomacy, the skills of being patient are important. So let's not throw out the baby with the bathwater. I accept there are clearly failings within the international UN system. I also think, as it happens, when it comes to the rules-based international system, the rules are actually there and protect most the weakest countries, the smallest countries, the ones who have the most benefit from a rules-based international system. And in many ways, the concern we have isn't just the rise of China and its views on this, but actually the sense of the United States of America and indeed middle class people in countries such as mine are much more dismissive of what the rules-based system is about. The sense of populism is taking a hold in much of Europe, but you know, with the Trump administration, the previously reliable guarantor of the international rules-based system, now questioning all the rules. Where I think the issue on China, one that I understand and I support, is one has to recognize that the rules-based system, as you know it, was put into place in 1945. It was put into place after two terrible conflicts in the first half of the last century. And therefore, the rules were made by victors of the war, by the United States, by the United Kingdom, by Russia, by France. And one has to accept, I think, that any rules-based system, you should certainly want to maintain a system, does need to evolve and adapt in time. And as I said, I think if you look at the changing economy that we have, the whole range of industries that are getting forefront, where we have no global protocol, a global protocol will have to be created for too long. All of which I think plays to the idea we've got to engage in a conversation that looks at the way in which we adapt to these systems. And let's not throw out what we've got. The fact that we have in the United Nations an organization that does come together. I was there, you know, one of my last visits only 4 months ago, I was sitting back at the bench, going out to Constance R, where over a million Rohingya are now in their own refugee camps. It is remarkable going out there to watch the resilience and the hard work of the Rohingya to build communities, but also the huge amount of work the international communities put in place. UNHCR building from scratch villages. Very tenuous villages in different parts of the world, and nonetheless, a huge amount of the international commitment effort that has gone to try to make life better for those who are the most vulnerable in these very difficult times. So, I wouldn't be in this world if I wasn't an optimist. I am an optimist by nature. Of course, I get frustrated, and I want things to happen now that can't happen. But as I say, it goes back to my point. You have to recognize the diplomacy, but often it is taking 3 steps forward to take 2 back. But recognize that each time you go through that process, you are at least making a little bit of progress, and you're beginning to engage in making pay what you've done.
Thank you, Mr. Minister.
Yeah, can you come to the mic? Thank you very much. I'm Al from the National Universe Group. Small group that we have, I'm a follower of Obama. My question is, during the macro of relationship between the UK and the ASEAN, are you going to strategize by having some kind of contact on the country basis? For instance, we have the modality, some ASEAN members are also members of the Commonwealth. And the other, maybe they will be. And the second thing is, now there is a paradigm shift for the EU party. They will find that the unbroken presence of the international forces in all over the world. Do you already have a thinking or strategy how to contribute, maybe via the UN system, to have secured the civilians of occupation? Because this new and forthcoming so-called institution in the Pacific, it will be amalgamated two big oceans, the Indian Ocean and the Pacific Ocean. Maybe also, and I'm sure you have interest in the two big oceans. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Listen, I don't want to step in the shoes of my colleagues in the Defence Department, but as I mentioned earlier on, you know, we do have an arrangement of defence terms in this part of the world with Singapore, Malaysia, Australia, New Zealand. And clearly we do things necessary for the UN as well, but I think we have existing partnerships, and increasingly partnerships with countries such as Japan, South Korea, where we do training as well in broader, as you would really know, very much our desire, and we appreciate it's not just for us to decide, it's for us and decide too. It's our desire that we should have a smooth process to remain dialogue partners as possible. We will obviously we're formally leaving the European Union on the 29th of March next year, but there will be a transition period. We will obviously maintain all of our connections during that transition period in the event. So of course we will continue to have good bilateral relationships irrespective of whatever status we might have with that ASEAN. As you might be saying, you know, with Malaysia, Singapore, and Brunei being in Commonwealth, there have been long-standing connections that we've had in place there. But I think that I hope that you will feel that we have much to offer ASEAN. I think ASEAN has quite a lot to gain from an ongoing involvement with the United Kingdom along the line side of that speech I've got. And above all, what I do think, what is so crucial is it is the people-to-people connection. In so many of these assets, whether it is scientists or academics being able to innovate research together, whether it is increasing number of students having the opportunity of travelling and studying, for example. But also, you know, the reality of the situation is known. Throughout the ASEAN region as a whole, 140,000 UK nationals live in ASEAN countries. Almost 3 million come here as tourists each and every year. And I think that it would be the right way forward for us to maintain those people-to-people connections in the broadest, deepest, and most comprehensive relationship between ASEAN and the UK in the future.
Well, thank you, Mr. Minister. I think from this exchange we have heard, and I think we also are convinced that there is a lot of interest on both sides and certain eagerness to cooperate in a much more extensive way than ever before. The new days in the context of the EU. And I hope that we can then become part of that effort at the think tank level. Well, thank you for coming. Give him a big hand.
Jadi ingat-ingat dulu lirik sama setelah ini.